atween the blink of the ee and the harn, atween the seean and the thinkan, time and space, whummelt and the swee. Dykes rise, fields, endrigs, nae pleuchd syne, rummel intill the lift. Gowd-licket cloods and black staunan aiks, o'er the gap atween seean and thinkan, thinkan and Daean, that her word micht come, Speiritan out of thon gap, Speiran at the yird and its cronies. Her ain word biggit, let him untack it and yoakan it, let it flee as the finger lifts and the air flees out the tame chaunter. Chaumer pipes for dancing and warrens for bleedin, Auld words for speaking and new ends for reading. There's the chink atween thinking and Daean. Drummer pipes for dancing and warrens for bleeding, Auld words for speaking and new ends for reading. There's the chink between thinking and Daean.
And now the chance to hear from a talk given by the inimitable Drew Clegg.
Robert Burns, and the language in which he wrote to a great extent and spoke, is already practically obsolete. So like multi-voiced and multifaceted Homer, Burns's tent is wheel-pegged dune in Parnassus, and he need fear nae evil. Of course, his immortality is predicated on the fact that he is a wonderful poet. A wonderful poet of enduring and international popularity. And as we know, reams and reams have been written over the millennia on the subject of poetry. You know, what is it? What are its constituent parts? How can we define it? And we have Aristotle's Poetics, for example. We've got Quintus Horatius Flaccus's Ars Poetica, for example. So Philip Sidney's Defence of Poetry, Percy Bysshe Shelley ditto. And we've got the preface to Coleridge and Wordsworth's Lyrical Ballads, which were themselves inspired by the works of Robert Burns. Many, many, many reams written on the subject. But to my mind, certainly the most concise and the clearest definition of poetry comes from the Little Queen Anne man, Alexander Pope, when he defined, with a typical aplomb, poetry as being what oft was thought, but ne'er so well expressed. And that sums up one of the qualities of Robert Burns to a tittle. He is the master of the succinct and utterly memorable phrase, or with some power the gift he gives, to see ourselves as others see us. Man's inhumanity to man makes countless thousands mourn. There's a phrase there that we would like to see vanish from the ether in 250 years' time, but perhaps it won't, and perhaps a phrase, that masterwork of clarity, will still be as eloquent in 250 years' time as it is today. And that lovely marrying that he was able to achieve between pure, crystalline, Augustan English and the lovely mellifluous Scots idiom, when he says and writes things like, "Oh, gently scan your brother man and still gentler sister woman, though they may gang a ken and rang, to step aside as human." The last wee line there is, could be straight from the pen of Alexander Pope, but the line before it, "though they may gang a ken and rang," has got all the hallmarks, one of Scott's idiom, and two of Robert Burns. His clarity is just astounding in these memorable phrases. I do not know of four wee words that have come from the pen of Robert Burns which are more expressive in any language, in any writing that I have encountered in all my days. Four wee amazingly expressive words, and one of them is a the. Let me give you an example. Suppose now I used to begin to tell you a story. Let's say about a family baker in a wee Scots town, for example. And they produce the best pies, the best scones, the best bleedin rolls that are available in their locality. And it's a generational thing, because the baker's mother and father were bakers, and his grandmother and grandfather were bakers. In other words, it's a wee lifestyle business, and it does very well. And then somebody comes along, this is a story I'm telling you, and says, here's a good idea, I own a big hotel chain. Why don't you guys sign a contract with me and you can supply your pies and buns and bread rolls and whatnot to every hotel in the land? And so the bakers invest in capital equipment, they take on more premises, they engage oodles of more staff, and then I stop the story and I say to you, but you see, the best laid schemes. And I need to go no further. Because the details of the denouement might be clouded and obscure, but we know the end of that story, because those four wee words, and as I said, one of them is a the, has expressed the whole tragedy to us. Wonderful example of clarity and brevity of language. And yet, what are those four wee words predicated on as to their meaning and as to their power? And this is where Robert Burns really comes into the shining lightdom of poetry. You'll know these other three words, but before I pronounce them, I did a little experiment one day with my nephews and nieces. I gathered them round me and I said to them, what does gang mean? Oh, that's boys and lasses hanging about the lamppost smoking the wacky-backy, isn't it? What does aft mean? And one wee girl said, oh, well, Papa was a seafarer, that means, that's a kind of shipping term, isn't it? Fore and aft. Aglay. Pass. Nobody knew. And then I put those three wee words in the context of the stanza from his poem To a Moose, and they all got the meaning exactly. And that is a masterstroke of poetry, for the meaning transcends the etymology. You do not need to know the meaning of the individual words for their full effect to wash over you like a tidal wave. I do not know of any other poet who's capable of bringing about that piece of magic with language. You know the verse, but if I put it in context, I think I can compare it with what might have been. But Moosey, thou wilt know thy lane. Oh, what a wonderful use again of Scots idiom, the diminutive, so that we get all the sympathy that the poet feels for the poor wee beast. But Moosey, thou wilt know thy lane. In proving foresight may be vain, perfect Augustan English. The best laid schemes of mice and men, perfect Augustan English. Gang after glay, and leave us not by grief and pain for promised joy. The whole meaning is carried by them three wee powerful, dramatic and demotic Scots words. Put the whole thing in standard English and you'll see what I mean. But mouse, you're not on your own, it doesn't even rhyme. But mouse, you're not on your own, in proving foresight may be vain. The best laid schemes of mice and men often go wrong. Oh, do they? Well, that's very memorable, isn't it? An absolute master of language. And oddly enough, in the same poem, there's the most extraordinary effect created in an earlier verse by a little compound word. It's where Burns writes, I do na whiles but thou may thief, but then peer beastie thou my love. And a demoniker in a thrive is a smart request. Demoniker. Well, we know what it means, don't we? It means the square root of not very much at all. But what's its etymology? What does it actually mean, a demoniker? That word would not be recognised in Kilwinning in the 18th century. Nor Ardrossan, nor Kilmarnock, nor Ayr. The folk of Auld, Edinburgh wouldn't have had a clue as to what it means. It was a word that was used within only a few miles of Mauchlin and Tarbolton. And it means half an ear of barley. Minority language. You can't get much more minor than that. Quite an extraordinary achievement, and that's just looking at one poem. of Robert Burns's canon.
Drew Clegg's talk on Burns was absolutely remarkable for the fact that he used no notes and was spellbinding for an entire hour. And it's a real shame that we can't include the entire talk in this podcast.